This is the 9th part of Amazon EKS tutorial. In this section, we'll talk about EFS file system. Now, let's go over some main features of EFS. First of all, it's elastic, meaning you don't need to worry about capacity ahead of time. This file system will scale automatically when you add or remove files. When you create a persistent volume claim or stateful set template, you no longer need to provide storage capacity ahead of time. Although Kubernetes requires us to specify the size of the volume. Since we use EFS, that size doesn't mean anything. Second, you can use ReadWriteMany access mode and mount the same volume to multiple pods at the same time. When one pod writes data to that volume, the other one will immediately see that file. Third, it's much more expensive than regular EBS volumes, so keep this in mind. To integrate this file system with EKS, we first need to create EFS file system in AWS. Then we need to create mount targets in all availability zones where we deploy our Kubernetes workers. We have two private subnets in two different availability zones, so we need to create two mount targets. Additionally, since it's a network file system, we need to use EKS security group to allow Kubernetes workers to connect to the EFS file system. Finally, we will create Kubernetes storage class and use the EFS storage class to allocate volumes using persistent volume claims or stateful set volume templates. At this point in time, EFS CSI driver doesn't support EKS pod identities. In the future, they will most likely update AWS SDK that they use, but for now, you have only two options. Either attach all permissions to the Kubernetes nodes, or the better option is to use OpenID Connect provider and link Kubernetes service account with IAM role. I think it's a good thing, and I can cover both approaches that you can take to authorize your application with AWS services. All right. First of all, we need to extract certificate from EKS cluster and use it to create OpenID Connect provider on AWS site. That's all you need to create this provider. Next, let's create EFS file system in AWS. There are a few configurations that you can change, but we'll mostly keep all the defaults. Next, we need to create a mount target in each subnet where we deploy our Kubernetes workers. Additionally, we need to open a firewall for those workers to connect to the file system. In our case, we'll use EKS security group that was created by EKS itself when we provisioned the cluster. Now, since we created two private subnets in the first section, we need to create another EFS mount target in the second private subnet. At this point, all Kubernetes workers will be able to connect to EFS file system. The next part is to grant all necessary permissions for the EFS CSI driver to attach volumes to our worker nodes. Because we use OpenID Connect provider, we need to create a trust policy and specify EFS CSI driver Kubernetes service account and the namespace where we will deploy it. Then create IAM role and attach this trust policy. Now, AWS manages one IAM policy for the EFS driver, so let's use that. Finally, we need to deploy it using a Helm chart. You need to specify the service account name, and most important part is to link Kubernetes service account with AWS using IAM role IRN annotation. In this case, we can dynamically pass it using a Terraform resource reference. Now, we need to initialize Kubernetes provider and use the same data resources that we used before to initialize Helm. So I leave it here for the reference. We'll use this new Kubernetes Terraform provider to create a custom Kubernetes storage class that uses EFS file system. Alright, let's go ahead and initialize Terraform because we added a new provider. Then let's apply it. Let's get the pods and verify that EFS drivers are running. Since EFS is a little bit more complex to configure, I would suggest tailing driver logs to check for any errors when you deploy a stateful application. Now, let me show you in AWS console how EFS file system looks like. Under the Network tab, you can find two mount targets that we created. And don't forget to use your security group, otherwise your CSI driver will timeout while allocating EFS volume for the Kubernetes pod. To test, I have prepared a single persistent volume claim with ReadWriteMany access mode that will attach to two different pods. We use EFS storage class, and even though EFS is elastic file system, Kubernetes requires us to put something under storage, so let's use 5 GB. Finally, we have two pods that use the same MyApp persistent volume claim. It is possible because it supports ReadWriteMany. Okay, let's apply it. You can see that both pods are running, which means we were able to attach the single EFS volume to both pods. In the next part, I'll show you how to use AWS Secrets Manager to mount secrets as environment variables and files inside the pod. We'll mount them as JSON objects as well as parse it and only mount the values.